Well, let me echo Mark's thanks for this brave crowd being out on a Friday evening, and to take the first moment here to congratulate Mark and Pat Jones for the vision and leadership that has not just brought this book to life, but as I think you got a sense in listening to Mark, just the formation of this global vision for what can happen, frankly, for what is happening, and as the book consolidates, gives us a roadmap for moving this issue to the global prominence that is really required. So thank goodness you'll be hearing from the amazing Anna Rollins, because like Mark, I have never even taken a theology course other than Anna know theologians. I would be in that category also of the applied Catholic social teaching person. And I think maybe if I could sum up what I've learned and how our organizations work, it may be the blend of Catholic social teaching and formed practice with the scientific method. And we have, as Mark described, I think not only because we believe it in faith, but we believe it because we have the evidence that homelessness is a solvable problem, and that the job now is to actually execute on that at a global scale. But let me just maybe start with, and I kind of followed a framework here that the great Marshall Ganz, a community organizer who's been a transformational figure in a lot of our political and community life in the United States, always urges people who've been trained by him to follow, which is to have a self and then move to us, what we've learned together and what we care about together, and then explain why the moment is now to take a new kind of action. And I think for Mark and me and people like Louise Casey, that many of you here would know, and is our amazing chair at the Institute of Global Homelessness, we came of age, we're graduating from college in the 1980s, when this actually was a new issue. You know, there had been periods of history, you know, depressions, wars, where there's mass displacement. But the idea that in times of peace and relative prosperity, you would have people, the most vulnerable people in our societies, in the developed world, living on the streets in increasing numbers, this wasn't something that we had seen before in our societies in the modern era. And one could believe, and I think this really unifies many of us who've been working and increasing collaboration with each other globally, you know, we grew up in a world where you did not see this. We know that this is a problem that's happened on our watch, and we can remember a world where this was, you know, believed to be unbelievable, intolerable, that we would leave vulnerable people sleeping on the streets. And so this idea of solvability has been very much a driver. But I'll tell you maybe why I came to even feel that I had a calling in this area around homelessness. Certainly didn't see it right away, but not unlike Father Jim, grew up in a family in the Hartford, Connecticut area that was parents very, very influenced by Catholic social teaching, didn't talk about it a lot, they just kind of did it. And we would, in our church, they would always find the people living alone or kind of on the borderline of you know, some kind of calamity, and they would end up at our house every holiday, and every Sunday we'd be visiting people, and this was just what you did. And it was only later, you know, frankly, in college, and you know, reading Thomas Merton in some of my religious classes, religion classes at a secular college, it was like, yeah, this is this personalist thing. You know, I actually, you know, experienced it up front with my parents' example. And one of the interesting things too about that that bias toward action, which is, you know, I can picture these scenes so vividly. You know, Mrs. Graysick having her social security cut off. My mother just got on the phone and figured it out. Or Frank Curran having a health crisis. My father just would keep driving him to the doctor. It wasn't like, what's the government agency called? He just kind of did it. And one of the consequences, interestingly, as kind of evolved in my work, was all of these individuals lived in various types of housing in downtown Hartford, boarding houses, old SRO hotels, this very kind of like crazy rooming house on Buckingham Street. But because I was the oldest of eight children, and the only one with a driver's license, my father's health worsened, it was my job to go pick up all of our friends on holidays. And so I ended up in some of the most interesting types of housing that probably any teenager in the Hartford area was seeing, and came to an appreciation, again, not really registering the implications of this, of how different kinds of housing and living arrangements were so necessary for the most vulnerable people, people living alone with different kind of social and economic needs. And so, fast forward, and what I thought was going to be just a one-year detour before the rest of my life, I ended up volunteering at a Catholic organization called Covenant House in Times Square, which at that time had opened up a very large shelter for runaway and homeless young people. And this was, you know, as I mentioned earlier, the early 80s, when this was a new issue and people were quite shocked by it. And this whole enterprise, which was growing in cities actually around North America, I think Covenant House might have had at least a dozen places by the time my year's volunteer service was over. But it was entirely public or privately funded, mainly by Catholics who were responding to a monthly newsletter written by the founder of the program. And at the same time, as I lived in the community center, is this kind of crazy old Baptist mission building near Times Square, but nearby was a Catholic church, Holy Cross, across from the Port Authority, and again, with this new issue, you saw the churches, mainly Catholic churches, but also other churches and some synagogues step forward and opening up their basements to during the winter months to provide the first shelters in New York. And so I would volunteer overnight once a week at Holy Cross during that year. And what was significant about that first experience of working with young people, working with these homeless women who would be bused to the church basement in the evening, was as a very young person myself, I was observing that that our kind of ideas about what was going on didn't quite match what people, these teenagers and these women in these traumatic conditions were actually telling me. A shelter, if we can all imagine, is exactly the right intervention if people have a short-term housing crisis until you can get to somewhere else. But just living in a state of permanent impermanence, yeah, is no kind of plan. And so for the first 2 months, I remember thinking, I just don't know enough. I'm just too young to figure out how this all adds up. And then increasingly, I realized no one actually has a plan here. These teenagers have nowhere to go for the most part. So put them out after 30 days, and they could come back another 30 days later. The whole thing was madness. An organization full of wonderful people, you know, they're volunteering and you know, supporting this organization, and I think, well, thank God this place is open tonight for the young people who are there, but what is the plan? And I had the same experience with the women at the church basement shelter. They'd be asking me how they could find housing, what they could do to, you know, get out of this terrible downward spiral, and I was like, I've only been told how to turn on the cot and when to put the cots away. And you know, so this idea that this thing was emerging and all of the good intentions and resources and, you know, the church as a first responder stepping up, but, you know, there was this other reality that was becoming very clear, that there was this new kind of systemic problem that the short-term program responses were just not matched for. And so yeah, after that sort of crazy-making year of being all about trying to do the right thing and realizing we probably weren't asking the right questions at all, frankly, listening to the women and the young people were saying, how do we find housing? I was like, let me learn how to, at least, who's building it, how affordable housing actually is delivered, and went to work for Brooklyn Catholic Charities, and was just, again, you know, well, not having been trained in Catholic social teaching, had the good fortune to be surrounded by people who were, and who were such formative experiences at that point. And the Diocese of Brooklyn at that time was led by two social workers, really remarkable men who were at that point, and, you know, all of us wish we had bought property in Brooklyn. You know, it was like, you know, every ethnic group that had immigrated to New York kind of built their own parish and stuff, and then everybody moved to Long Island. So you'd have blocks after blocks of church properties that were empty, falling down. And Bishops McGovern and Sullivan were like, go see what you can do, build housing. That's what people need. And so I had an amazing mentor who led the housing office and had the experience of learning how to, nothing like housing to teach you history, community organizing, design, finance, politics, had the chance to convert a number of church-owned properties into affordable housing for different groups. And ended up going from Catholic Charities to begin my own not-for-profit group, actually in response to this, Mark mentioned the Times Square Hotel in the middle of Manhattan, which was a very public disaster at the time. It was in bankruptcy, it was being foreclosed, emptied out, and it's like, well, I think I have an idea for that. And so kind of improbably ended up having to create an organization because the idea took hold that you could take some of these buildings that were actually perceived as problems in their community, buildings that had historically served single adults with very little money, and actually make them very decent places to live, bringing a different set of values around creating a community that was well-designed, well-managed, the services right there that people needed in order to get their lives on track again, mental health and employment and health services, and actually creating a mixed community, not simply people who are coming from the trauma of homelessness, but who were low-wage workers who also needed support and a chance to live well and safely and affordably in their home. Well, the good news is, you know, that project worked, and we went on to build about 3,000 efficiency apartments in and around New York City. But something, you know, was becoming more and more evident, and you know, when you see that you're kind of making excuses all the time for like why it's somebody else's problem, it's usually a good cue to like stop and think. And finally, I did, because while we and others were building more and more housing, homelessness was going up. And so it became more and more hollow feeling to be talking about our great solution to homelessness when it was not reaching by any means all of those who needed it. And housing is an essential, and affordable, decent housing is an essential part of ending homelessness. But it was becoming clearer and clearer that there's another dimension to this, and that nobody was owning that. And so I remember going back and forth, and this is probably around 2000. Is our mission ending homelessness, or is it running good programs? And because I really didn't have a sense of how you got to that ending homelessness, even though that's what I always had believed, that this isn't a problem that we should have, it was really quite a period of reckoning to realize that it was nobody else's job. No one wanted that job to figure out what was not happening and how do we have not just more of a good thing, more housing, but less of a bad thing, less homelessness, and that those two things didn't equate, and that some new way of thinking was going to be required. And so we actually started experimenting by sort of like claiming that space that nobody wanted. How do we start with the people living on the street and find out what it's going to take to help each of them get into a home, rather than starting with buildings and just thinking magically, this is all going to sort itself out. And the place we looked for inspiration first to think about what could be different was to the UK. I had been reading about, it was early in Tony Blair's first term, the relaunch of something called the Rough Sleepers Initiative. And one of those things that can only be described as providential. I was like, who is this Louise Casey? How would I get in touch with her? This is like pre-internet, at least pre-R, kind of widespread adoption of at Common Ground. And as I'm, like in this two-week period when I'd read something about Rough Sleepers, I was like, maybe they call it British MC. So I'm trying to figure this out amidst the usual chaos of running these buildings. And I got a call from someone who was an advanced person for, it was Hillary Armstrong, who was a member of parliament, who the staff person said, Minister Armstrong and Louise Casey would like to come and visit your building. Like, what? And so, yeah, so here she was coming to see us. And so we quickly started taking what was happening and was primed to happen here about Louise, as any of you who are living in England at that time would recall, was around focusing on reducing street homelessness by 2/3 in 3 years. Well, what was riveting when I read that was, like, how did they even know when they get there? Because we have no clue how many people are experiencing homelessness in New York. And as we've just kind of entered into this new space of taking responsibility for this issue in kind of our completely earnest but ignorant way, what I had already found was the advocates were claiming at least 100,000 people. And the city was saying, maybe 1,000. You know, and so it served no one's interest, it seemed, politically or advocacy-wise, to know the truth. What are we contending with? How big is this problem? What does it look like? How is it moving and changing? Where is it located specifically? And so Louise and Ian actually was part of that early kind of exchange program between the UK and New York, came over and helped us do the first street counts in the Times Square and Midtown New York area. And after a while, we had to kind of battle our way through the skepticism, like, oh, like, why are we doing this? And now, as you'll hear, data is the big story. But actually having, I saw firsthand, even though it was, we did like one street count a year, and we knew that wasn't the perfect way of measuring, but it was a starting point. And I could see, even as we totaled the numbers, that just the people who we'd recruited from different organizations, their aspect changed, because they realized there's so much they didn't know. We had some of these very well-intended folks saying, we know exactly who's out there. We got about 35 people. Well, it was like 419, and this isn't about, maybe a 200-block area. And so it just was a very somber and challenging moment for everyone who thought they had the ball. Well, outreach worked 9 to 5, Monday through Friday. Nobody talked to each other from the different organizations. We're all dealing with the same problems, the same people experiencing it, without any kind of shared response or coordination. Well, to fast forward, realizing that you had to start thinking differently, organizing groups of organizations and people differently, and actually knowing what you're dealing with in terms of the numbers of people experiencing homelessness and how people were experiencing it, was the provocation, really, to start a new organization. We didn't do it right away. We incubated what's become Community Solutions as part of Common Ground. And we learned a lot about how we had to change as an organization. We hadn't thought about some of the really backward-looking practices that we employed as far as how we selected residents. Like most landlords, you'd think, who's going to be the most successful tenants? Well, we had to really prioritize who are the people who need our housing the most. And there's this whole reversal and kind of learning at every moment about, who are we for? Are we for our organization, or are we for the people who need our help the most? And so as we moved out into this new world of really thinking about street homelessness, what would it take to end street homelessness, we and in launching what was to become Community Solutions, we started paying more and more attention to what we were learning about those individuals who were on the street. And as any of you who buy the book at the 40% discount mark is promoting, will find my essay in it is about the overlap between health and homelessness. And the slide you are looking at behind me is, I think, one of the most powerful that, it illustrates one of the most powerful stories that I hope you take with you, and I refer to it in the essay. This is a group of men who were homeless in Boston, and a wonderful man, Jim O'Connell, Notre Dame grad, street physician who was one of the founders of the healthcare for the homeless movement in the United States, took this picture of a group of his patients and then showed it to me a few years later and said, all but one of these men is dead. And so this was like 2 years after the photograph was taken. And if you look at these men, they do not look, you know, that they're, you know, broken down and in this imperiled state. But it's just a very powerful reminder that homelessness is not a natural thing. People do not choose to be homeless. People is ruinous for their health. We know from studies after studies now that a person experiencing long-term homelessness, it's up to 25 to 30 years life expectancy gap. If you think of the call to be there with and prioritize the most vulnerable, it's hard to find a group of people in our wealthy societies who are suffering more and more at risk of an early death. And so when we began our organization, it was, and Mark referred to it, it was kind of with a bang, with this call to other communities around the country to take what we were learning back in Times Square, where we had really tackled street homelessness and figured out, you know, with much learning and coaching from the Rough Sleepers team here in the UK, what it would take to get to a really sustainable reduction in street homelessness. And it took us 4 years, but we got to an 87% reduction in street homelessness in the center of Manhattan, and learned a lot about what needed to change. You know, just very, you know, kind of fierce, you know, data-driven collaboration and just constant iteration. We had to train up our teams in basic data analytics and quality improvement. We had to just break so many rules, you know, and but it was really kind of even bringing to the city of New York an awareness of how the unintended consequences of various rules around eligibility and contracting, things that sound so mundane but actually make the difference between literally life and death for people like these men. And so we took what we'd learned in Times Square about what it took to actually drive reductions in street homelessness and to increase the speed of housing placement, kind of make housing placement the goal rather than how many meals have you distributed or how many contacts have you made. You know, some of the things that were kind of embedded in contracts that really made no sense. Like, all of these good organizations were doing what they were supposed to do, but those activities didn't have anything to do with reducing people's, you know, experience of homelessness. And so when we launched our national organization, it was with this invitation to cities around the country. Like, we think we are beginning to see what it takes to end street homelessness, to end chronic homelessness. Who wants to learn in public with us? You know, and you have to fund yourself. So great invitation. But wouldn't you know, this goes to what is latent in so many, you know, communities. So many people care about this issue and just haven't been given the right invitation. And so what we called the 100,000 Homes Campaign was this vision of how do we collectively identify and house 100,000 of the most vulnerable people living on our streets in the country in a 4-year period. And ultimately, 186 communities signed up. And together in the 4 years, we were able to house more than 105,000 people who've been living on the streets. And I wish I'd developed 100,000 years of housing. It's really just persuading other people to figure out their housing, but helping them, you know, kind of understand that it was as much a systems problem, which sounds wonky, but it's basically like, how do the parts fit together? Or how are you making sure that people have a seamless experience of assistance from people whose intentions are good and really, you know, didn't sign up for like just being the rule mongers and just citing eligibility, but to solve a problem. And so we were able to really kind of shift the ways that many, many people working in the sector thought about this issue and what needed to be done. And how housing, you know, is a process, not just, you know, a product. It's how housing actually gets matched to people who need it and what type of housing and how affordable it is and whether it's supported in the right way. And so all of that was was phenomenal. We couldn't have been prouder of the communities and the amazing people who came together to do this. But there was one problem, and we realized it even a few months later, which is when we started surveying, you know, everybody kind of took a breath, started calling the communities back, like, okay, how are you keeping up your housing placement rate? And a lot of these communities were like, oh my God, are you kidding? We were exhausted. We're just like, well, things were just creeping right back up. And we're like, oh, that wasn't the point. You know, it's like to really fix this for good, not just have this one really powerful experience together of getting the problem, you know, moved. And so I think, you know, and I hope you're picking up this, we, I think, for sure, at that moment, learned to befriend failure. Just, like, do we stop now, or do we, like, go back to our original intentions? Truly, you know, to end homelessness, end street homelessness, and to figure out a way to do that with the coalition of the willing. And so a few months later, we're like, you know, we're not, the work isn't done. Who's in? And 70 communities signed up then to just keep going until the work was done. And it took us 2 years of really, you know, just, you know, using the disciplines that we had acquired. We knew how important data was, and having a sense of the how, you know, the as close to knowing in regular time how many people had been housed that month, how many people were newly into homeless. We knew that this had to be about community teams, that this was a population level issue. This wasn't about hoping that programs would come together and all of their good work would add up to a solution. We knew that communities need to have different kinds of training in using data for problem solving, not just for filing reports. And that we, the tools of quality improvement and how you just keep working a problem and knowing whether it's getting better, these were all things that we had learned, we were teaching others, we were learning from them. And the breakthrough came when all of these communities, I think 27 of the 70, had housed even more people than, based on our projections, we thought they needed to house to be at zero, and only one was at the end of that year. And I'm like, you know, what are we seeing? And the insight, and I remember the moment my amazing colleague, Beth Sandor, who's one of the co-directors of this national effort called Build for Zero now, said, you know, I think we're going to need person-specific information in real time. And you know, we're all looking at each other thinking, but that's not possible. How could you understand a problem that is so distributed, people who many times don't want to be known or found, how could you know what was happening all the time for everyone and be able to work from that base of knowledge? And you know, on the one hand, it sounds, you know, sort of abstract, but on the other, I mean, if we were to take one lesson from Catholic social teaching, it's that we all matter. Until you get down to the specific human being, you can't solve a population-level problem. And that insight, well, we scrambled and went back to the communities and said, do you think we could do this together? Get to the point where no one is unknown at any moment, and to see the whole problem whole and everybody experiencing this problem. Well, it took a while, but we now have 73 communities who know how to do that, and more getting there. And what has been powerful is once communities get to what we call quality data, they know who's experiencing homelessness in real time and how they're experiencing homelessness. We see that it's actually much more like a medical issue than we even imagined, because it's like, imagine going to an emergency room and everyone in it is just given the same treatment. It would be, you know, ridiculous. But that's what we've been doing, all of us, you know, well-intentioned folks, for so long, treating housing crises as though they're all alike. But knowing the person in real time, having the individual story, understanding how to match resources, working as a team beyond organizational boundaries, this is actually what is transforming the work. And we now are seeing these capabilities of communities to actually problem solve in real time to the person level is actually the source of the breakthrough. I want to shift kind of scale a bit now to talk about the work that, with Mark and Famvin and the Institute of Global Homelessness that's happening now. Because I think this is all of a piece with this idea of we have to think bigger. We have to really understand the tools that are needed to enable us to work in a much bolder, more rigorous way. And we need to be thinking of ourselves as members of a global team, not just local and national teams doing this work of ending street homelessness. And one of the things that I thought was lovely in its irony was this summer, Malcolm Gladwell, who's a popular author and podcaster, had Father Jim Keenan, who is actually the patron and the sponsor of this book, on his podcast because that was called Thinking Like a Jesuit. And it was all about this concept that I would have learned about had I taken a theology course, no doubt, called casuistry. And for those who have not listened to the podcast or gone to and have had theological training, it's basically this notion of if you are on the frontier of something, in a new place, look for a pattern. Try to understand, what is this situation like? What can I draw from in history that can guide me in terms of understanding the nuances and an ethical way forward? According to Father Keenan and Malcolm Gladwell, the Jesuits needed this when they were going into China and Japan. Like, what are they going to find there? So, imagine something back in London or, Portugal that would have been the guide. And so what we found as we started moving into this, how do we solve this problem broadly? And we're seeing what's working locally. What we started seeing, this casuistry kind of driven way, was the way communities were working and the communities that were actually beginning to drive reductions in homelessness and see these powerful shifts, they were working a lot like teams working on global health issues like polio eradication here in Nigeria were working. Very clear, measurable, shared goal. All about the data. What's real? Not like what do we wish or think has happened or we estimate what happened. What's actually happening in real time in specific locations? Just like everybody's on the same team, whether you're from the international health organizations or you're the community health worker. You're all in the same room, figuring out what you're going to do next on a complex shifting problem. And you're adapting the closer you get to zero because some of the patterns fit like for the first 50 or 60% of the way. But then things get really complicated with people with very different challenges than you've seen before or locations that have unusual barriers. But this idea that what we were learning in helping communities end homelessness was actually a practice and a model that had been figured out in other places, particularly global health, but aviation, complex construction sites. Again, I think the world of the 21st century is a world of collaboration. No one can do these complicated problem-solving tasks alone. It's a world where very specific data is needed to understand how a problem is moving and changing and to allow us to react effectively and to invest our resources well. And that you don't get to an end state where, we're done. It's like you have to get to a state where your team and your knowledge base is so robust and able to adapt and to learn continuously that you can stay ahead of the problem. And so one of the very exciting things in my life and in our work has been, thanks to Mark's leadership, to begin to be able to share what's learning here in the States and also work throughout Canada and helping Australia stand up a similar movement, is to be learning now from a global network of cities that have been brought together under IGH's leadership to begin exchanging what's working, to begin to arrive at a common definition, as Mark described, to begin together moving this issue onto a new plane at the UN and the Vatican as an issue that that is so essential for, you know, the most vulnerable people on the planet, and to begin mobilizing the kind of commitment, resource, investment, global attention that the issue has demanded. What's been very exciting in the last 2 years has been seeing this IGH effort, which we have, gosh, I think now 13 cities on six continents, now part of a very active learning network. What's it going to take to get to sustainable reductions in street homelessness in very different contexts, from Asia to South America to Edmonton in Canada to Shawnee in South Africa, and also to have that supplemented by the Famvin Homeless Alliance. And when I was first getting to know all of these incentions, I was like, "What? There are 2 million of you? Like, what an army!" And that Mark has, with leadership from many incredible people in these incentive organizations, has really, I think, for the first time, seen the possibility of giving a clear goal, a deadline, you know, a shared definition of what can happen, and out of this rich incentive tradition of action over words, just get started and learn and measure and assume there's a solution and take responsibility for finding it. That you know, we see what we're learning in the United States through the Built for Zero initiative and through these other countries where we're now beginning to assist their practice, that you know, these innovations around how teams solve complex problems can be spread so dramatically through the Catholic networks, where it's actually an issue that has long been recognized as so central to the ministry and the mission of people working in Catholic contexts throughout the world. And so I'll track back to Built for Zero just to tell you why, in closing, this is an issue we can win on. If I can advance this. I don't think anybody's going to be rushing to the phone to call the Times or anything, but this next week, because they just got there this week, Chattanooga in Tennessee, this is a county city of about 900,000. They've become the 14th community in the United States to end veteran homelessness. You know, they've done it. They've held it for 6 months. You have to show that your system is robust, that this wasn't like a one-day event. But like you nailed it. People are working in new ways. People are not coming in and languishing if they're a veteran experiencing homelessness. And the Chattanooga team is already well along in ending chronic homelessness as well. We've designed this to be sort of population by population to give communities an opportunity to, you know, win with a whole series of milestones, you know, just to build out a system that ultimately will touch everyone. We are likely to have the first two communities in the United States, Rockford, Illinois, community of about 360,000, and Gulf Coast, Mississippi, which is a community of about 600,000, 90 miles along the Gulf Coast. Very poor state, interestingly, but, you know, so it's like, it's not about the money, it's about, you know, how you work. Both of those communities within the year are likely to have just ended homelessness. They're that close. And, you know, we are seeing these proof points come behind, you know, what from a values and moral standpoint we've always believed was true and necessary. We now have the data and a sense of how the work works. And altogether, we're now, with Chattanooga about to be announced next week, 14 communities have ended homelessness for a population. Another 42, and we're now up to 85 communities, another 42 have now seen steady reductions, including in big cities. You know, I say it's still the coalition of the willing. You have to want to do the work. And ironically, the places, and sadly, the places in the United States that are almost most iconic around street homelessness, they're like, no, it's an affordable housing problem, just send money. Just like, no, actually, you don't know what's going on. That's the starting point for any community. You just need to know who's experiencing homelessness and how, or you're not going to make headway on this issue. But these 85 communities in the last 3 years have now housed 115,000 people. Most of this, actually, with just finding resources they already had and repurposing them. And I'll say that one of the other powerful things that's happening, and I think just does happen when you couple, like, it's the right thing to do, and we actually know what the heck we're doing. We now have some pretty phenomenal and very hope-filled partnerships with healthcare systems, with other corporations, that mortgage providers, home builders, are like, we see this as our issue too, but we never thought there was anything we could do that would really make a difference. And so I feel at this moment of, like, a new kind of urgency, because the fact that now we know that this is a solvable problem for sure, and what you need to do, you're in a new place than when you were just trying your best. Like, there's a new sense of moral responsibility to just get it done, spread it everywhere. But there's also, I think, a moment of just compelling readiness in the world. I had a chance to meet with a group of philanthropists and business leaders yesterday, and just decided to go for it. So, you know, we can win. Homelessness, street homelessness in the developed world, even without great data, the estimates we have suggest that no more than 1% of the population in any of our countries in the global north is experiencing homelessness. That is a total last mile problem. And we can get this job done in a world where we're wondering what to do about climate change, around terrorist threats, around, you know, so many areas of injustice. This is a solvable problem, and we know the world needs a win. And we also know that we have such a powerful blueprint, not just because we understand kind of the data infrastructure, we understand the kinds of training, the community mindsets, all of the different practices we're going to need to solve any complex problem. You can actually learn your way into those new habits by solving this problem. And I thought it was so powerful after I was like, we can solve this problem. So what did they laugh? Probably 13 people, maybe 14 business leaders and philanthropists came up and gave me their card. I said, what can my company do? What can my foundation do? Can you send me that PowerPoint? People, I think, can rally around this issue in a new way, because I think, you know, we all know that this should not exist as a problem. And I just want to, you know, return to thanking Mark and Pat for their leadership in putting this book together, because it actually is helping to surface knowledge, practice, beliefs, and a whole army of people who share values around this issue.